A balanced and nuanced discussion of a very complicated and often highly charged issue. So our thanks to John for his excellent work in this regard. And then it is my distinct privilege and pleasure to introduce our next speaker, who really doesn't need a lot of introduction in this town. Born in South Dakota and a graduate of the South Dakota State University, he became an intelligence officer in the Air Force. And then this country was very, or at least South Dakota was very intelligent in electing him in 1978 to the House of Representatives, where he served for 8 years. He then in 1986 was elected to the Senate from South Dakota, and 8 years later he became the Democratic leader and has a fairly unique distinction of having served twice as a majority leader and a minority leader for the Democratic Party. Today he is a senior advisor at Alston & Byrd. He's a board member at the Center for American Progress, and he's one of the founding members of the Bipartisan Policy Center. He has thought a lot and written a great deal and very persuasively about healthcare policy and other public policy issues. And recently he's been writing somewhat about our subject today, so it is with great pleasure that I introduce Senator Tom Daschle.
Well, Sally, thank you very much for that very generous and kind introduction, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to be with you. I'm here for two reasons. One, because I care a lot about the issue and wanted to encourage your continued participation as we attempt to work through many of the challenges we face in this democratic republic today. But secondly, because I have just enormous admiration for the two people who are our hosts and the organizers of this event, Sally and Bob. I've known them, respected them immensely for years. Bob has kept me out of trouble for decades, literally, and I have immensely appreciated his enormous help over the many years in so many different contexts that I can't begin to talk about it. But it's a pleasure to be here. There's a story of the time Harry Truman and Chaim Weizmann, the first president of Israel, we're meeting in 1948 in the Oval Office, and Harry Truman commented to President Weizmann, "Mr. President, you lead such a small country. How would you like to be president of 180 million people?" President Weizmann replied to President Truman, "Mr. President, how would you like to be president of 2 million presidents?" I think of that comment and that story because in part that's what this conversation's about. We have about 320 million people, and I think at least 2 million of them think they should be president, act as if they were president, and in part are the cause of the polarization that we are experiencing now. This is one of the most polarized environments that we've seen, not only in my lifetime, but I think in all of American history. And it's largely a conversation, a debate, discussion ideologically between those who see America built solely on the strength of rugged individualism and those who credit our strength to collective action. That, in essence, is the ideological spectrum that is at its core the debate today and the cause of much of the experience that we are currently witnessing with regard to polarization. Right now, that division seems almost irreconcilable. Those who believe, on one hand, that really it is up to the individual to continue to build this country as they have so successfully, and those who believe that we couldn't have done anything were it not for the collective action. But history has shown, I think, collectively and individually, that over the course of the last 200 years, these two ideals are not mutually exclusive. That in essence, it is built on both rugged individualism and collective action. But at its core, this debate between those two ends of the ideological spectrum have a lot to do with what we perceive today to be the proper role of government. No one argues that there should be no government at all, and therein lies the second spectrum. What should be the role of government from that extreme of no government to that extreme where government does it all? I've long described this debate, ideological and political, as the noise of democracy. It's not a very concordant sound, not very stereophonic, but it sure beats the noise of violence that is oftentimes what we hear in countries like Egypt and Syria, Libya. I could go on. And it beats the sound of silence, where people disappear because what they believe. And so the noise of democracy is part of this cacophony in this debate that in some ways we celebrate, in some ways we lament. The noise of democracy has had much more volume in recent years, largely as a result of the addition of the loud voices of the Tea Party. They believe deeply and obviously that the role of government should be extremely limited, that government really can't do things, most things, right, and should therefore do virtually nothing at all. And because of the fear that the group has engendered politically, they have mostly gotten their wish in recent times. By any account, this has been the least productive Congress has been in my lifetime. It's largely because Congress has been paralyzed by partisanship at a greater degree than anything we've seen at any time in a long time, perhaps in memory. But it's not the first time. It was the mid-19th century when we saw polarization at levels even worse than they are today. They actually passed a resolution in the House of Representatives that all fisticuffs had to occur off the House floor. And we all know, of course, the infamous moment when Congressman Preston Brooks beat Senator Charles Sumner to within inches of his life with his cane, actually breaking his cane over his head, and incapacitated Senator Sumner to a point where ultimately his ability to serve in the Senate came to an end. But today there is a vocal and united minority who believe not just in an ideological position, but also in a tactical one. And that tactical position is that to do anything other than stand your ground is tantamount to capitulation. That is, in essence, your role here is to stand your ground, to forcefully defend your position, never, ever to compromise, never to find common ground. But we all know that in a country of 320 million people, without finding common ground, solely relying on standing your ground, keeps us from the quality of governance expected by our founding fathers and certainly by the very definition of a democratic republic. And so that's where we find ourselves today. There's little recognition. It's almost impossible, really, to reach our potential levels of accomplishment and achievement legislatively and enacting good public law without people ultimately reconciling their position, their attitude, their tactics with regard to the approach they take ultimately to the issues of the day. I used to keep a photo in my office that Bob may remember of Lyndon Johnson towering over Theodore Greene, senator from Rhode Island, demanding his vote. I couldn't do that. Towering over anybody is really not my strength. But I think a lot of people long for the day that a majority leader could simply corner a senator, twist his arm, and get his vote. That is the perception of what it was we have been able to do through good leadership, strong leadership, from the very beginning. But you know, in his 6 years as majority leader, from 1954 to 1960, if I were to ask you how many filibusters, how many cloture votes do you think Lyndon Johnson actually experienced, you might be surprised to know that the answer is one. It was the Voting Rights Act of 1957. In his last 6 years, Harry Reid has had 322 cloture votes. We've had more filibusters on nominations in the last 5 years than we've had in all of history. And the prospects for enactment of legislation on taxes, on energy, on trade, on immigration, on climate, on education, all stand at nearly next to zero. I know you've spent the morning talking about all of the factors that are at play with that realization, and so I fear I may be a little redundant in giving you my own views as to what it is that I think has brought us to this point in Washington and in the country. I would divide the factors into little things and big things. Kind of a scientific way of looking at things, I guess, but I obviously would assert that the big things are much harder to fix, but they're also obviously by far more important. On my list of big things, not necessarily in any order of importance, begin with, of course, candidate selection. And I know you've had a lot of discussion this morning about that, but in the context of candidate selection, there are two major factors. The way we select our candidates in primaries, they become increasingly disjointed. A smaller and smaller number of people with greater and greater organizational and resources, organizational skill and resources, are able in many respects to dominate these primaries in large measure because they have the realization that participation in the primary process is so limited in our country. So it really doesn't take a lot of people. It simply takes a good organization and good resources with lots of media to dominate oftentimes the primary selection process. And in states that are largely one party, that happens all too often today. And the second, of course, is gerrymandering, the fact that we have allowed elected officials to pick their voters rather than to have voters pick elected officials. And because elected officials pick their voters, they're very selective. And you have to look hard to find states that have really set the standard for which we ought to divide up and make some fair assessment as to ensuring a level playing field with regard to these districts and the rights of all voters to be represented. There is one state in particular that stands out, and that's Iowa. Iowa has a number of very specific rules with regard to how districts should be divided and determined. You can't divide a county in Iowa. They have to be contiguous in Iowa. They all have to be within 1% of each other in population. Iowa now has 4 congressional districts. They lost one in the last census. And in my view, it's no accident, no coincidence, that the current representation from the state of Iowa in Congress is 2 Republicans and 2 Democrats. But Iowa, sadly, is the only state with rules that tight and with guarantees about equal representation that good. So I would say the primary process and the selection of our candidates through the gerrymandering, or the lack of gerrymandering in the case of Iowa, has had a lot to do with our current circumstances, and I'd be happy to talk more about that as we go forward. The second major factor is the airplane. The airplane is more responsible for what we see today in Washington than almost anything else I can tell you. And the reason it is because we've made it far too easy for members of Congress to spend far too little time today in our nation's capital doing what they were elected to do. Believe it or not, a typical week now entails leading on Thursday and coming back on Tuesday and governing on Wednesday. That's a little bit of an exaggeration, but not much. Almost no one moves their family to Washington any longer. And because it is now so easy to get back to your district, most members don't even have residences in Washington. And there are a lot of repercussions as a result of that fact. The fact that they don't spend any time here means that they don't really get to know each other that well. And if you can't know each other, you can't really begin to communicate. And if you can't communicate, you can't build relationships. And if you can't build relationships, you can't build trust. And obviously, if you're not here, the very fact that you only have limited time within which to do everything that governing a country of 320 million people requires means you don't have time to do the things you were elected to do in the first place. I can't emphasize enough how important it is that members spend time in Washington doing what they were elected to do. But increasingly, that becomes one of the major problems as we look to the challenges we face in governance in the 21st century. The third major factor is the media, and I know you've had some good conversations about that as well. It used to be the media, in my view, was the referee. Today, in large measure, the media is the participant. The participant in the debates, the participant with blogging and with all the other aspects of social media that involve integration and engagement in many respects in a positive way, but also in many respects in a far less responsible way. The media has become a vastly different set of circumstances than when I came to Congress in 1978. Then we had basically three networks, and Walter Cronkite told us the facts, and we believed him. Today, as Winston Churchill once said, rumor gets halfway around the world before truth gets its shoes on. And that is the stuff of blogs and the stuff of cable news and all of the other factors that today make media so much more complicated and encumber, in my view, the real possibilities that our founding fathers envisioned as they thought of what the fourth estate ought to look like and the participation they ought to be expected to provide. The final major factor is the one that very few people would dispute, but I can't emphasize its importance either, and that's money. Money. A typical United States senator has to raise $10,000 every single day he or she is in office. $10,000. But $10,000 isn't raised every day. So what happens is that, I'll never forget having a conversation with Pat Leahy once. We were talking about that I love to run in the mornings, and I was commenting to Pat that I usually run 4 miles a day, and he said, well, that's my goal. And he said, when I don't do 4 miles one day, I just add it on to the next day. He said, I'm now 1,473 miles behind. Well, that's what happens in fundraising, that we don't raise $10,000 a day, so most senators leave it to the last 2 years. And because they are 1,400,000 or 10 million or 20 million behind, literally, they spend 8 to 10 hours a day in small cubicles dialing for dollars. Or they're on the road constantly, in the air, I should say, is more like it, going to fundraisers. I just attended a fundraiser this morning for an incumbent running for re-election. But money has become so much a part of a senator's role in public service that it is not an exaggeration to say that two-thirds of your time in the last 2 years of your election is spent raising money. Not legislating, not responding to constituents' needs necessarily, not doing all the things that I would think would be important in any democratic republic, but raising money. And it's getting worse. It's getting worse. My first race in 1978 cost somewhere in the vicinity of $600,000. My last race within those same boundaries cost $25 million. And by today's standards, that's a bargain compared to the $40 million spent in two of the races in the last cycle, Virginia and Massachusetts, on either side. So money is a problem that will only get worse until we address it. But that is the last in my list of big things. Now let me move to the small things, some of them related to the big things. And the first is calendar. The schedule for the second session of this Congress has just been announced, and the Congress will spend 113 days in session out of 365 next year. That's about 10 a month. Does anybody really think we can govern with 10 days a month? I listed just the short list of legislation required. I didn't talk about budget. I didn't talk about all the other things I could have added to the list. But we've got 113 days in 2014 to govern this country with all of the challenges we face. And if anybody truly believes that that's enough, I'd love to have another longer conversation at a later date. There are other little factors that I don't expect you all to agree with, but I'll share them because it's what I believe. I think the loss of earmarks was a real travesty. Travesty in part, and maybe that's too strong a word, but I think it was a travesty in part because I think elected officials ought to have a say with regard to how money is spent. It should be transparent, but it ought to be a factor as the decision-making process includes both the executive and legislative branches. But from a far more practical point of view, I cannot tell you how many times an earmark made the difference on a vote for a member of the Senate when I was trying to persuade people to do the right thing. Legislators feel invested if they have something that they can bring home to their constituencies. I've had several conversations with many of my predecessors, and almost, I can say unanimously, every one of my predecessors as leader on both the Republican and Democratic side said that one of the most persuasive and one of the most effective ways that they had to bring consensus and reach real agreement and move legislation was the earmark process. Was there abuse? Absolutely. Could that abuse have been addressed in ways other than just eliminating earmarks? Absolutely. But that's something that I think we're going to have to revisit at some point in the future. The third small thing is transparency. I'm for transparency, but too much sunshine can burn. And it does. Transparency sometimes is a very limiting factor in creating the kind of conducive legislative environment that you need to get the job done. Bob will remember this because he was so incredibly important to the effort. But during impeachment in the 1990s, one of the questions we faced as we organized the Senate to take on this historic responsibility was, should it be televised? And we had a hard time coming to a real agreement because of the sensitivities involved, and this hadn't been done in 100 years, way before television had even been imagined, much less a part of the legislative process. But over a period of time and a number of discussions back and forth, we decided there would be a certain time at the end of the day when the sessions would not be televised. when members would come to the floor and express themselves, and we would have a discussion off the record. I cannot tell you how profoundly different it was between that time when everything was televised and that time when it wasn't. Some of the best speeches, some of the most profound moments, some of the most emotional experiences I had was when the cameras went off and members went to the floor and just poured their hearts out. But whether it's something as dramatic as that, or whether it's just negotiating, or whether it's discussing a matter of great importance in a committee, unfortunately today that lens changes the environment dramatically. Now, I'm not suggesting that we turn the cameras off. I am suggesting that we use more discretion on when we use them and when we don't. I think there has to be more candor, more opportunity to be truthful, more occasions within which all of us can be more open. And until we deal with transparency, that will not happen. Another in my small list is the Hastert rule, so-called. This notion that you have to have a majority of the majority to do anything is just ridiculous. We didn't elect just a majority of the majority to dictate the policies of any party or any body in the Congress. This is a rule that only initiated, obviously by definition, in the last 10 years, and I think it was a very, very counterproductive practice. We ought to say, look, we're going to create a majority of the body, and that majority of the body will have the opportunity to move legislation. Today, you're going to see an example of that. I believe that a majority of the body will move this new budget agreement. It was a small step to doing the right thing, but I think you're going to see a large percentage of Democrats and Republicans working together to pass somewhat meaningful legislation. That is the way it should be every day, not just on rare occasions, but it doesn't happen enough. My next nomination for small change fix are the caucuses and the way we run them. Both Bob and Sally have been involved with a lot of caucuses, so they've probably shared some of this with you in some other setting. But I think the caucuses have really become a double-edged sword. Lyndon Johnson refused to have caucus meetings. He had one a year in January. We now have two a week, sometimes three a week. And these caucus meetings really become pep rallies. And they're put in the context of sports analyses all too often, where it's our team versus their team, and we're going to score this afternoon by doing X. And I look back at those times when I really thought it was important that somehow we try to bring out the best in the body. And it was those times after crises only that we really did it. We had joint caucuses right before and during impeachment, right after 9/11, right after the anthrax attack. Whenever there was a crisis, we had a joint caucus, and it was incredible. You had Republicans and Democrats sitting together, and nobody was saying, here's what they did to us, here's what we're going to do to them. You know what we did? We all sat down and said, we got a problem, how are we going to fix it? And we sat together. And in sitting together, we kind of got to know each other a little bit better, and what do you know? We got through those crises in a reasonably good way. But the crises end, and so do the joint caucuses. I have urged the leaders to have joint caucuses. They did one about 6 months ago to pay tribute to John McCain as he marked the anniversary of his tragic capture. He told the most emotional story, and I'm told not a person left that room dry-eyed. That was the last time there was a caucus, a joint caucus. They ought to be doing them weekly. Filibuster practices. there's a lot of discussion and controversy around filibusters. I think Senator Reid was left with no other choice but to do what he did on nominations, or even, as you know, the Senate was in session all night last night because members still have the opportunity to play out the 30 hours before you have the vote. I just think it's abhorrent that we are in the position we're in today as a result of the change in attitude on filibusters. I think that there was probably another way to do it, but one way or the other, it had to be done. I mean, we changed the filibuster in two ways over the last 40 years. The first was to do something that we thought was going to make the Senate more efficient. We started doing what we called dual tracking, where a filibuster would begin and the leaders would set that bill aside and take up a second track. Well, we're now quintuple tracking. There isn't a name for how many tracks we've got going with all the filibusters there are on nominations and legislation. So dual tracking didn't do anything but made filibusters even more accessible as a tool. Second thing we did was to say you no longer have to hold the floor. You can call quorums and you can do a number of things that really don't require your presence physically on the floor any longer, and that was a huge mistake. If we'd go back to the days when, number one, we didn't dual track, and number two, you had to hold the floor, I'm not so sure we'd have 322 filibusters in the last 6 years as what we've had. But it's almost impossible to turn back the clock, and so other ways to deal with this intransigence had to be found, and Senator Reid did what I probably would have done as well. But we have to address the way the Senate rules are functioning today. My final small thing, and some of these are debatable whether they're small or large, but at least they're, I think, in the context of the larger challenges we face, still smaller. My last one is just something pretty basic, and that's socializing. I am really troubled by the fact that there's so little real socializing that exists today. And it goes back to my comments on the airplane. You know, the airplane is in part the cause, but it's also the money, and it's also the change in the political climate today. But it's amazing how little socializing goes on, how little opportunities there are for senators and congressmen to spend some real time together. It used to be senators carpooled in together. They literally came from the suburbs, and they rode together into work and back home again. They used to do picnics and events at night. None of that happens any longer. And as a result, as I said a moment ago, the fact is that not many people really know each other any longer. And without having that comity and without having that socializing environment, so little trust and so little appreciation of one another. I have the good fortune to talk to newer members sometimes when they come in. They give me a call and say, I'd just like to know, what should I know about this place before I get started? I just did it again recently. And I said, well, number one, reach out. Invite your colleagues over for dinner. Have lunch with them. Spend some time on a weekend with them sometime. And by all means, if you can possibly do it, take every CODEL you get invited to take. Congressional delegation trip. Those congressional delegation trips are enormously helpful in allowing people to bond. When you're on a plane with somebody for 14 hours, you really do get to know them, and it makes a huge difference. And unfortunately, there are still those who are apprehensive and very concerned about whether they should take CODELs, and I just hope that that's also something that gets the kind of attention and priority it deserves. Fixes require addressing all of these factors, large and small, but it also, at its very heart, goes back to the very fundamental question I was talking about at the beginning, which is we've got to decide as a nation, as a country, as a Congress, what is the role of government? I'm very involved in healthcare issues and have a passionate belief about the direction I think our country should take with regard to health. But that really is the debate about health as well. We agree on the problems, cost, access, and quality. We agree on the causes. We even agree on what the goal is. There should be a high-performance, high-value healthcare marketplace with better access, better quality, and lower cost. What we can agree on is what the role of government is in getting there. But that's true on just about every one of the issues we face today. It's also a function, frankly, of leadership, national leadership. It's a function of finding people that are able to rise to the occasion, just as we've done on so many occasions in the past, the Washingtons and Adams and Jeffersons and Lincolns and Roosevelts. We need people to rise to the occasion just as much now as we did at those critical moments in our history. The consequences of dysfunction and paralysis will become increasingly problematic, and I would argue even potentially catastrophic, unless we deal with them. And that's why it was such an honor to be asked by Bob to come and speak with you today, because I believe this is so, so critical to the future of our country. I started with a story, I'll end with a story. Benjamin Franklin in Philadelphia. If you've read his biographies, you probably know this story, but the second night they were gathering, as he was walking out, late one night, a crowd had gathered as they started to do each day of their deliberations. And as he stood on the steps, as he was walking out of the building, a woman yelled to Benjamin Franklin, he said, "Mr. Franklin, have you decided what will it be, a monarchy or a republic?" He thought for a moment and he yelled back to the woman, he said, "Ma'am, it'll be a republic if we can keep it." And that's been our charge ever since he uttered those words, keeping this republic. And what's amazing to me, and we don't often think of it in this context, but 1 million people have died fighting for it over these 200 years. 1 million people, think about that. 1 million people have thought so much about the importance of keeping it that they died for it. All you have to do is go out to Arlington and you can appreciate the magnitude of that sacrifice. The rest of us have to work at it. The rest of us have to take these factors and we've got to figure out how we're going to work at it so that we too can keep it. And not only keep it for us, but keep it for my grandkids and their grandkids. And that, I hope, is in part why you're here. Thank you all very much.
Well, Senator Daschle's strength may not be in towering over another senator to get his vote, but I think his thoughtful and articulate analysis of our society, our government, and our politics is indeed towering, and we thank him for that very much. He has graciously agreed to take some questions, so we do have the microphones ready. Thinking quickly, I see one hand there.
Senator Stuart Sloan, thank you so much for your remarks, Senator. I have one question. When you mentioned all the obstacles and changes in the rules, what do you think the impact has been on the Senate of the the institution of term limits for chairman? Has that been a negative in terms of keeping the caucus together and getting things accomplished?
Well, that's a very good question, and I guess I would just emphasize that the Democrats in the Senate do not have that rule. The Republicans do. The Republicans have had it in the House and in the Senate now for some time. I actually am not generally in favor of term limits, but I think if I could make an exception, it might be for the chairs of the committees. I think having some rotation is generally a good thing. And so while I wouldn't be supportive of term limits across the country, I do think that ability to rotate and shared responsibility is good. It's worked well in the Senate for the Republicans. I wish that the Democrats would do it as well.
Rick?
Thank you so much for coming. You talked about money in politics, but you talked about it in a way that is different from the way most people typically talk about the problem of money in politics. And I just wanted to make sure everybody heard it that way and then ask you a question. You focused overwhelmingly on the amount of time that now has to be devoted to fundraising, and that's part of traveling and being out of town so often as well. Your statistic of two-thirds of the time in the last 2 years of a senator's term being devoted to fundraising. Most people talk about the corrupting influence of money or the concern about special interests and the like. You're talking about the demand on legislators' time. And so what I wanted to ask you, especially since you're not in office now, would you be in favor of significantly raising, for example, the contribution limits on the amount of money that individuals or other actors can give to candidates, or in favor of raising the contribution limits on what can be given to political parties? Because certainly a significant part of what drives that demand on your time is not just the need for lots of more money, but it's the fact that you have to raise it in dribs and drabs. And do you think the difference between, say, contribution caps of 7, 8, 10,000, whatever, versus the current 2,600, you know, would that actually significantly add to the risks of corruption, or would it be a positive reform from your perspective?
That's a great question, and I should have elaborated more, because I certainly would not want anyone to interpret my comments as not being concerned about the influence that it buys as well. I think increased limits would only have one ultimate effect on money in politics, and that's to inflate rather than to in any other way affect the process. I don't think that money necessarily buys votes, but it buys access, and access buys votes. And I think we have to be concerned about the implications. As I travel internationally, I'm amazed at how many people raise the issue of money in American politics today and can't quite discern the difference why it's not appropriate to give a bureaucrat money, but it's okay to give a politician money. They ask me to give them an understanding, and frankly, it gets harder and harder to do. But that's, they say, you know, we chastise other countries for their corruption based in large measure on access to money. There's a huge corruption scandal going on in two countries right now that probably many, but at least India and Indonesia are both having serious corruption trials as a result of money. And just coincidentally, I've had conversations, and they say, you know, who are you pointing fingers at when you've got the challenges you face in your own country with regard to the access that money buys? And so I think we have to be very concerned about that. I was thinking of it more in terms of its implications for the necessary allocation of time and resources as we make decisions as senators, but clearly the access question is one that cannot be overemphasized.
Back of the room. Can you wait for the mic, please?
Policy Center, and with all your work there, my question is, you're an excellent diagnostician. What's your remedy?
Well, I somehow to address each one of my items on the short and the small and the large list. I mean, I think we have to look at each one of those things. I would start by saying, let's address the small things. Trent Lott and I just wrote an op-ed in the Post a couple of days ago or a week ago, and we started to address the small things. Joint caucuses. You know, I would double. I would go from 123 to 146 days here in Washington next year to get that legislative agenda really with more of an ability to address the challenges we face. And I know it's an election year, but that's what it used to be. And so But there are ways of addressing each one of those things. Let's say at least 3 weeks out of every four, you're going to work here 5 days a week. We're going to have votes on Monday. We're going to have votes on Friday, and maybe even Saturday and Sunday if we have to get the job done. It just seems to me joint caucuses, you know, retreats. I wish the president would outreach more to the leadership than he does. There are a lot of things that could be done to begin making real progress with regard to creating the kind of environment conducive. We're not going to, this cacophony of voices and this noise of democracy is still going to be pretty loud. But I think even with the cacophony, there are things we can do to create a more conducive environment. Let's deal a little bit more with this transparency issue that I was talking about. I'd love to have more opportunities for people to be able to speak candidly than they can today. All of those things are small starts, but they're important beginnings.
Last question from Chris.
Thank you for being with the Senator. One of the things that I've done a little bit of reading about is the extent to which polarization tracks income inequality. We had Rick Davis here who mentioned that both Ross Perot, the sort of Ross Perot movement and the Tea Party movement have also tracked times when the economy has not been doing very well. And I wondered if in your time in office, if you had seen any correlation between the times when the economy was not doing so well and the times when it was, and maybe the extent of income inequality, and if you saw any increase in polarization accordingly.
Well, I guess I don't know if there's a direct correlation between income inequality and the time Congress spends in Washington, but I would say it's at its very core, it goes to this question of what is the role of government, because I think the more we minimize government's role, the more unable we are to address some of the tools that we have available to us to more effectively bring about more income equality. And I think that's one of the challenges we face, resolving this debate over time is going to be necessary. But again, look at something as basic as the minimum wage. We haven't had a minimum wage increase for years in this country. Other states have really picked up where the federal government has failed. But that's not necessarily a function of lack of time in this case, but a lack of commitment on the part of those who are here to address these issues in a more meaningful way. But I guess I would go back to, again, partly it's because we don't have the capacity to talk to one another in a more effective way. And that is a function of time spent in Washington.
Thank you very much, Senator. And I would just like to close by saying that our goal in arranging this program as the conclusion of our clinic was to try to stimulate a civilized, constructive conversation about polarization. As we learned starting very early this morning, this didn't happen overnight. It will not be solved overnight. But if you leave here today and keep thinking about this issue and keep the conversation going and devote just some of your very substantial skills and talents to resolving it, then I think we can call today a great success. And on that note, I thank you all very much for joining us in another round for Senator Daschle.